Good afternoon. Welcome and thank you all for joining us for the 2017 Edward J. Ross Lecture in Litigation. For those of you who I don't know, I'm Gregory Mandel. I'm the interim dean at Temple Law School. And I'd like to extend a particular welcome to Helene, Edward Ross's wife, and to all of the Ross family members and friends who are able to join us here today for this lectureship. While we know that this lecture is only one part of Ed's legacy, we are humbled and we're grateful that you have chosen Temple Law School as the home for these conversations. It's also wonderful to see so many faculty colleagues, so many students, alumni, and friends of Temple Law School gathering here today. This is a time of year when there is lots going on at the law school. And so everybody in this room, I know, has to make difficult choices about how to spend their lunch hours. And we're pleased that all of you chose this conversation. To our alumni and friends who I see around the room, we're delighted to have you back on campus. We're always delighted to see you back here, and today is no exception. Since becoming interim dean last summer, I've had the privilege to get to engage to a greater extent with many of our alums, with other friends in the community, some of the rich connections that Temple has throughout the region, and that's been a fabulous opportunity. So many people feel so strongly about the law school and the law school's mission, and it's wonderful to be able to engage in conversations with all of you in that regard. So I'm grateful that you've taken the time to come back or come to North Broad Street for this afternoon. I'm sure you will find your time well worth it. The Ross Lecture in Litigation is one of those times during the year when we at Temple Law School get to reflect upon who we are and what we do and the mission and the values that we serve. Ed Ross was tireless in his pursuit of justice, his pursuits on behalf of those who were powerless to be able to speak. And that obviously dovetails quite nicely with a lot of the lessons that we try to teach here. Ed was an advocate in every sense of the word. He brought passion to his pursuits. He brought integrity and excellence to all the things that he did, all the things that he engaged in. We've had the privilege through this lectureship of hearing from a number of speakers, from many speakers at this point, whose work and lives were driven by those same ideals. And today's speaker is going to join that group, is someone else whose passions lead him to pursue these same important goals of justice. I'm sure that all of you are as eager as I am to hear from Stuart Lev, and so I'm going to limit my remarks and turn it over to my friend and colleague and the director of our advocacy programs, Jules Epstein, who's going to introduce Stu and get our show on the road. Thank you all.
Good afternoon. A very quick request, if you haven't done it already, would you kindly make sure your cell phones are off or on vibrate, whatever. All right, so it's tremendously distressing to stand here because according to the New York Times, a Harvard law professor and Justice Kagan, Stuart Lev should not be giving this lecture. Why do I say that? In February of 2016, Stuart argued in the United States Supreme Court. In August of 2016, the New York Times published an article that claimed that while the civil bar has terrific, terrific advocates in the United States Supreme Court, people who argue 10 or 20 or 30 cases, according to this Harvard professor's study, criminal defendants are almost never represented by expert counsel in arguments before the court. And Justice Kagan said, case in and case out, the category of litigant who is not getting great representation at the Supreme Court are criminal defendants. So I read the study last night. How can this be? They use the wrong metrics. So work with me, because I hope to show you that, boy, did they get it wrong, especially when we talk about Stulev. So how can I show you that? Well, I could tell you this is like my best friend for the last 30 years, and I'm the guy he calls when the plumbing backs up. But that's singularly not helpful. I can tell you he's a great friend of this law school. Stu taught here. He's helped mood our appellate students. He's been a real friend of the school. I can tell you he's nationally acclaimed as a trainer of capital case lawyers, of federal appellate lawyers, of federal defenders. I can tell you, and this is where the New York Times and the Harvard professor's study got it wrong, he's argued in state Supreme Courts and federal circuit courts and has more of those coming up. So you don't have to just have US Supreme Court arguments under your belt to be a tremendous, tremendous advocate. And Stu, you drive me nuts, okay? We train our students. There are only a few rules of appellate advocacy. Please never say, that's an interesting question. So there we are in Washington in February last year, and Justice Alito looks down at Stuart and poses this really complicated question. And what do I hear? That's an interesting question. Have the transcript. But that's because he's so good, he can break the rules. And just like you laughed, they laughed, and then he nailed the answer. But maybe there are two more compelling reasons. Stu changed the face of the law in the United States, and in my view, reinvigorated the guarantee of due process. The case he argued had the following language. The court now holds, in other words, we're saying something new. Under the due process clause, there is an impermissible risk of actual bias when a judge earlier had significant personal involvement as a prosecutor in a critical decision regarding the defendant's case. That changed the law. So here's my last reason that the New York Times is wrong, and I bet my friend Stu would say this is the one he would cherish the most. I'm going to read you some names. Kelvin Morris, Freeman May, Jimmy Dennis, Terry Williams, Ricardo Natividad. These are all Stu's clients. These are people, every one of whom he has helped. These are people, every one of whom he has found the humanity in them. And what you really need when you're going to be an advocate in front of the United States Supreme Court is not only the, oh, I've done this before, and not only the art of advocacy, but a real caring about your clients. So, New York Times, respectfully, Justice Kagan, and that Harvard professor, you're wrong, we're right. You get great representation and excellence in advocacy when Stu Lev is up in front of you. Will you please join me in welcoming our speaker? You're in trouble now.
I know. Well, thanks. So let me say that the article in the New York Times really upset me when I read it, and not because of me, but because of public defenders, because I thought the article was really unfair, not to not separate out the amazing work done by public defenders and the federal public defenders who've appeared and won dozens of cases in a very hostile Supreme Court and have done an excellent job, and not recognizing the work that's done, and that's part of what we're going to talk about today, by people who've committed their careers to representing people who have power and who have no voice, and who give them the voice to be able to go up and talk to the Supreme Court and say, this system needs fixing, I thought was really grossly unfair. So thanks for mentioning that, Jules, but please don't let it think it's about me. It's about a community of people that I'm very fortunate to be a part of. Okay, so the first thing I want you to do, everybody here, is after Jules's introduction, is to take a deep breath and lower your expectations. Right, because I'm not going to be that interesting, and giving speeches is not what I do. Right, I'm not a good joke teller. I have a joke to tell that my wife told me not to, but I'm going to tell it anyway. It's a crime joke. A snail goes into a police station. See, Jules already knows it. A snail goes into a police station and says, "I was just robbed by two turtles." The police officer says, "Tell me what happened." The snail says, "I can't. It happened too fast." Right? Not my strong point, but a good joke. Public defenders have stories and love telling stories, right? That's what public defenders do. They try cases, they do appeals, and they tell stories, right? And I'm not the best storyteller, but, you know, I got a couple of stories. I got my client who when searched by the police, he was stopped and frisked on the street, and the police officer testified that he felt a large object that appeared to be a lot of wrapped bundles in his pocket and said to the defendant, "What's that in your pocket?" And the defendant said, "I don't know. They're not my shorts." not a great defense. And then there was the client who, during jury selection, when the judge was voir dire the jury, and said, "Has anybody in the courtroom ever been convicted of a crime before?" Raise his hand. So that panel had to leave, and a new panel had to be brought in, because jurors don't get to know that. But again, telling stories, not my strong suit. Giving speeches is not. I'm an appellate lawyer primarily. I've done trial work, but I'm primarily an appellate lawyer, and appellate lawyers don't give speeches. And this is one of the big mistakes that people who when they're doing their first appellate argument or who haven't really been trained as an appellate advocate make. They think they're going up there to give a speech, and you're not. You're going up there to have a conversation, right? To answer questions from the court. The court's not interested in what I have to say as much as they're in about what I think is important. They're interested in what they think is important. And so they drive the conversation. And you're a participant in that conversation. And that's what I hope we can do a little bit today. As we go through this, I will ramble on and you will get bored at some point. So when you do, raise your hand and ask me a question. It's much more dynamic, it's better, and we can have a conversation. And we'll certainly have time for that at the end, to have that conversation. So let me step back. The other thing you're going to know, and for those of you who know me know well, I have these notes in front of me. I can't see them. I have really bad eyesight, and I need to keep switching my glasses quite a bit to look at my notes and make sure I'm not missing anything. So when you see me look at my notes, forgive me for doing so. Okay, so let me go back. Let me take a step back and start with my thank yous. I want to thank Temple for inviting me, Dean Mandel. Are you Provost Epps now? Provost Epps, who thankful to have her here, my friend Jules, my friend Lou Natale, and everybody else from Temple. Jules is right. I grew up in Philadelphia, and I watched Temple Big Five basketball since I was a kid, and have a warm spot for Temple as a really important institution within the city of Philadelphia. And I've just met in my career so many lawyers who've graduated from Temple who are just such good lawyers. Public defenders and private lawyers and other people. And Temple has just done a great job of turning out people who are really passionate and really good lawyers. And so I'm always happy to come and participate in Temple events. And I thank you for having me. And I want to thank the Ross family for inviting me. Really honored. Helene and Joan. Most of you don't know that the Ross family is very close friends with my family. And I've been friends with Helene and with Edward for many years. And so it's really an honor and special to be here and to be channeling Ed and wearing Ed's tie. When Ed passed away much too young, Helene gave me some of the things that she thought I would want. And one is this tie. And it's an Armani. It's the only Armani I ever owned and that I ever will own or that I could afford. And I'm really honored to be here today and to have a chance to talk to you. And mostly I'm talking to you people sitting up there, right, to the law students, because that's what I want to talk about today. I want to talk about the conversation I want to have is about how to have passion in your work, about what gives us satisfaction as lawyers, what makes being a lawyer something exceptional and satisfying and pride in your work and in what you do, and that can be done. There are too many lawyers, right? When you talk to lawyers, I'm a lawyer, you know, who work hard and struggle with the work. It's tedious, it's hard, and that they're not getting the satisfaction. We see a lot of lawyers who leave practicing law every year because they're just not getting the satisfaction from the work. And so largely what I want to do to you is to talk to you today about why representing people who lack a voice, who lack power, brings such enormous satisfaction. And such enormous pride in the work that we do and how it can make you happy in a career. And it doesn't have to be as a public defender, not by any means. My friends at Legal Services who represent the poor and the downtrodden, who try to get a fair shake in the system, who are about to lose a lot of money if the current budget proposal goes through and who need to be supported. People in private practice and big law firms who do pro bono work, who take some of their time and energy to do work on behalf of people who couldn't afford them otherwise, people who work for state and federal governments, who want to make sure that the programs that are being implemented as fairly and as well as possible. People who come to work every day proud of what they're doing and taking pride of it. That's what makes you happy, right? I've been a lawyer now for 39 years, right? I graduated law school in 1978, and I still like doing it, right? I've been a public defender all that time, and I still feel when I get up in the morning, I don't really want to go to work. But once I get there, right, I go, this is where I belong. This is the place to be. And that's what I encourage you young law students who are looking out for your careers, that's what you need to be looking for. It's like where are you going to be happy? Where are you going to wake up in the morning and go to work and say, this is the work that I want to do? And you know, I'm going to tell you my story a little bit and Ed's story a little bit, and hopefully that can help set an example or give you some things to think about. And if we have the time, we'll talk about the Terry Williams case and my experience in the Supreme Court, which was really a remarkable experience. Not the actually being in the courtroom was the finale of it, but all the things that led up to it and the tremendous support I had from a community of people, including Temple, where I came here and did one of my moot courts. I did 5 moot courts to get ready for that, and still no one asked me that question that Justice Alito asked me. Somebody should have thought of that in advance. But they got they nailed every other question between the five courts. So I was well prepared when I got there, and it was that collaboration and community of effort that I find within the public defender community that has also helped motivated me through all these years. But let me talk to you a little bit about Ed before I start talking about me, because Ed, as Dean Mandel pointed out, there's a connection between Ed's vision and what I do, and it's even a deeper connection than that, because Edward loved public defenders. He was so excited when I came back from Philadelphia. So the Ross family and my sister and brother-in-law who are here have been friends for a very, very long time. And Edward, who was the kindest and most compassionate of people, took care of my parents. He did all my parents' legal work. When my parents had an issue, call Edward, right? And Edward came right over, because he treated my parents like they were his parents, right? It was all family to him. And then I was in Michigan. I went to law school in Michigan and then was practicing law as an appellate public defender there. And when I came back, Edward was very excited that I was back. And when I got the job at the Philadelphia Public Defender Office, he was again thrilled that I was being a public defender. He loved public defenders, and he loved public defenders for a number of reasons. He was one. It was what he did early in his career for a little while. Helene told me yesterday on the phone that he got held in contempt and thrown into jail. And that's a story I'm not sure I ever heard. So you need to tell me that story one day about which judge he pissed off enough to do that. And you know, for the most part, being held in contempt for public defenders is a matter of pride and a badge of honor. Jules was in the public defender's office, he was the apologist for the office, right? When somebody got held in contempt or a judge called up and said, you got to do something, right, they sent Jules over to straighten things out, because Jules can soothe a lot of nerves. So Ed's and public defender ran in the family. Ed's sister-in-law, Helene and Joan's sister Rita, who died tragically and in a tragic event, much too young. She was a public defender. I got to meet Rita when I started. I didn't get to know her very well before she passed away. Ed's son Jonathan was a public defender for how many years? When he was in law school, worked for the public defender. There's a deep connection there. And the deep connection is this vision of justice, this vision of speaking out for people who don't have a voice, of helping people who need help navigating the complexities of a very complex justice system, whether it's the civil justice system or whether it's the criminal justice system. It's complex and it's difficult for everyday people to know how to deal with that. And on the other hand, those people who control the system or who have power, who have influence, who have the money to be able to affect and try to control the system. And you're fighting those forces, right? And so that's your job, is to speak up for those people who don't have the resources to be able to speak up for themselves. And Edward believed in that as a general practitioner, representing people who just came to him needing help in whatever field. He did some civil work, he did some criminal work, he did some family work, and then he found what became his career in representing the victims of sexual assault. So Edward, we now take it for granted, right? That institutions have protected people who were working for those institutions and who had a history of committing sexual assault against young men and women who were part of those institutions. But it took a long while for that to come into be known. And Edward was one of the early lawyers who started to see these patterns and meet these people who'd been abused and said these people need help. These people need a voice. And he took that on, and it became the thrust of his career and the thrust of his practice with his partner Steve Rubino, and that they did amazing work helping people recover from the trauma that had been done to them. One of Edward's cases, the one that fascinated me the most, that I loved hearing him talk about, took place above the Arctic Circle, where there was a teacher employed by the Canadian government who was going from Inuit village to Inuit village teaching the young people, who was also sexually abusing some of the young men along the way. And so Edward litigated on behalf of them, and he spent a lot of time traveling up to some little Inuit village above the Arctic Circle doing depositions and talking with people and learning that. And I begged him over and over, take me with you. I want to see it. He goes, there's nothing to see. It's a rock, right? Right? It's a bunch of barren rock and trailers and Quonset huts. There's nothing to see. And I'm going, and that was Edward, though. He didn't care where it was, right? He didn't care what the forces against him was. If he felt there were people who needed a voice, he was willing to take it on, and that's the passion that he brought to his work. That's the vision that he brought to work, which I think is really, as Dean Mandel said, is really what to me this lecture series is about. That in many different ways, for many different lawyers, that you bring that vision and that passion that what you're doing is helping others is really gonna, you know, set you in a career that's gonna be satisfying. For you, it's going to make you happy and to do it. So then there's me. How did I get into doing all this stuff? How did I become a career public defender? I'll give you the short form version of this. I'm a Philly guy. I grew up in Northeast Philly. I went to Philly public schools. I graduated Northeast High School, class of 130, if anybody else was there. That was a lot of years ago. And I was a child of the 60s and 70s. And so when I went to law school in 1975 in Michigan, I went to law school very much driven by the purpose of wanting to do good, wanting to do social change work, wanting to do things that would help people, that would help this vision of having people being fairly treated within the justice system. I didn't know what I was going to do, but I knew it was going to be something like that. And so law school was really a time, I went with that perspective, but law school is really a time that shapes you and shapes the way you think. And it was hard sometimes to maintain that perspective. I went to Michigan, which is a very conservative law school, even though people don't know that because it's in Ann Arbor, a very liberal city. But it was really a very conservative law school and pushed, I think, a very conservative program of law and what they expected their students to do after graduating. And it was hard. It was to keep that challenge of trying to do something different, trying to do something that was people-oriented. And there were a couple of things that kept me going and that really formulated my way of thinking. One was the National Lawyers Guild. I don't know, do we have any guild members? In the room, loved the National Lawyers Guild, more important now than ever. There was a lawyer from Detroit named Ernie Goodman, who was one of the founders of the National Lawyers Guild. And I remember my first year in law school, Ernie came and spoke, and like I couldn't believe this guy, you know, he was white-haired, grandfatherly kind of guy who represented communists in the 1930s and 40s and 50s, represented people before the McCarthy Commission, who represented labor unions and pushed for labor unions, who started the first integrated law firm in the city of Detroit with with subsequently becoming Congressman John Conyers, who went to Attica, who gave up his practice. He was a personal injury lawyer in practice, but who gave up a time in his practice to go down south with his son Bill, who was also a lawyer, and work in the civil rights movement, who after the uprising at Attica prison, took time off from his practice to go and represent the people who were charged with crimes out of the Attica riots. And I listened to this guy and I said, this is who I want to be. And I won't ever be Ernie Goodman. He blazed paths that I can only follow. But he was, and through the guild, others like him, gave me that sense of what I can do and what I can do. And I hope all of you, whether it's the Lawyers Guild or something else that excites you about your career and why you're here and what you're doing here, that you find those people who you can look up to and that you can follow them. The other thing that helped me was there was a professor at Michigan Law School named David Chambers, David had been appointed a master of a consent decree at the Washtenaw County Jail, which is the county where Ann Arbor is in. And so he had a project of law students, excuse me. He had a project of law students who went into the jail every week and talked with inmates and heard their problems, tried to resolve them, talked with the jail officials, talked with the sheriffs, documented the problems, and tried to see, gathered the data so that David could report on whether the consent decree was being properly enforced and properly honored. And that got me started to kind of think about criminal law, and I heard a lot of stories from people about why they're in jail, and of course once inmates accused get a listening face, right? They're not going to just tell you about their problems in the jail. They're going to tell you about their problems in the system and what led them to be in jail. And it was just really interesting, and I learned a lot, and I also learned that I could be helpful. Right? That because of my position, even of just being a law student, I could be helpful to people. I could be a voice to help deal with some of the problems, not all of them and not always successfully, but to at least be that voice to help talk to the prison. And that got me started. And then I learned, and I apologize to all the Temple faculty who are here, that I didn't really like law school that much, right? I didn't really like the classes, right? They were okay, and I was learning new ways of thinking and new ways of being a critical thinking, but it wasn't what I wanted to do. I didn't want to succeed in class. I wanted to succeed using the skills that I was learning in class to help people. And that became my focus in law school. I had part-time jobs at legal services. I worked in Detroit at the Juvenile Defender Office, which was a really great experience because I not only got to do some research and all, but I got to go to court, right? I got to go into juvenile court at detention hearings when people had gotten picked up and advocate on behalf of my clients and talk to their families and see if there were if they could go home safely and be safely in the community and take care of themselves in the community without having to be locked up. And I got to do that, and I really liked it, right? That stuff, being able to use the stuff I was using in class in a practical way was really good. So back in those days, clinical law was not clinical programs was not very big. Michigan had a couple of them. And today, much more emphasis on clinical law. Temple has a great clinical program that gives people the opportunity to get some of those experiences, to take what you're learning in class and use it in a practical way to help people. So I encourage all of you to do as much of that as you can, to take what clinical law classes you can, to think about not just doing well in class And yeah, sure, try to do well in class. That's important, and that's going to help you down the road. But think about how can you use it in a way that's important and meaningful to you. And the clinical programs that schools teach, the advocacy program, the chance to do trial ad work, to learn the skills of lawyering, as well as the critical thinking that lawyers do, is a really important way to make law school, at least for me, a much more meaningful experience than just going to class and just focusing on the classwork. So the last clinic I took in law school was an appellate defense clinic that Michigan had a statewide appellate public defender, and one of the appellate public defenders taught a class each semester, and we had real cases that the lawyer brought with us that were assigned to us, and so I took that class, and it was taught by a woman named Barbara Levine. And she passed out the classes, and she says, I want you all this week to read the notes of testimony. They were all fairly short trials. And come back next week and tell me what issues you see. And we'll have individual conferences, and we'll talk about the issues. And I said, okay, so I go, I read it, and I go, there aren't any issues in this. Now, my friends here from the appeals division of the Philly Public Defender, they go, of course there are issues, right? You just got to be aware enough to find them. I go, no, there aren't any issues here. And I go back to Professor Levine, and I'm a little chagrined, and I go, I can't find any issues. She goes, that can't be right. You must be an idiot. let me look at it and come back next week. So she looks at it, and I come back next week, and she goes, you're right. there aren't any issues here. I'll have to deal with this. Why don't you help me with this? I have a client, an 18-year-old boy, who was convicted of a rape in Saginaw, Michigan, who had horrendous representation, a lawyer who was just pitiful in his representation, who got convicted and sentenced to life based on a one-witness identification and no forensic evidence committing of a crime. And his conviction's been affirmed, and I've been wanting to do a habeas petition for him. Would you be interested in working on the habeas petition? I go, yeah. Right? That sounds really interesting. So I started working that, and you know, it clicked. It clicked for me. It clicked with Barb, who then hired me as her law clerk. And eventually, when a position became open at the appellate defender office, I got hired by the appellate defender office and spent 7 years there before I came back to Philadelphia, knowing that what I wanted to do was to still be a public defender. And although the PD's office wasn't hiring and I had to do some other stuff, including 6 months as a family lawyer, where I learned that representing accused criminals is far less distressing than representing people in the midst of divorce and custody actions. I have a lot of respect for people who can do that. It's really, really hard. But then just as I was wondering what was going to happen, I got a call from Ben Lerner, who was then chief at the public defender office, and said, Stu, I have some openings. You want to come? And so I did. And Ben was interesting. Ben said, look, I don't hire appellate lawyers. I think that was a mistake on his part, but because I think appellate law is a specialty. He goes, I hire people who want to be trial lawyers. And then if you want to do some appeals, that's okay. And I said, good. Because I wanted to learn how to be a trial lawyer. I wanted that experience of being in the courtroom and talking to juries and talking to judges and that immediacy, right? Right. Being an appellate lawyer, there's nothing immediate. You write a brief and you wait. You give an oral argument and then you wait for a decision. Trial is immediate, nerve-wracking, but immediate. And so I did. I became a trial lawyer for a while and went through the Defender Trial Training Program, a great program, and I tried cases before judges, and I tried a few before juries, and I realized it was too nerve-wracking for me, and that I was better suited as somebody who can sit back and think about what they do, who can express themselves in writing more persuasively maybe than could express myself orally. And so I ended up back in the appeals division with terrific lawyers and terrific people. And then in 1996, the Federal Defender Office, which was part of the Defender Association, started in the end of 1995, they decided they had to get involved in doing death penalty work. And here's what was going on in Pennsylvania. Because of some uniquenesses within the Pennsylvania structure, there were hundreds of people on death row, I think about 246 at the time. But very few had been to federal court yet to do their habeas corpus petitions. And there weren't motivations. Governor Casey was the governor at the time, and Governor Casey, who is a devout Catholic, was very hesitant on the death penalty, and he didn't sign many warrants, and he didn't push the cases forward. And so there were a lot of cases that were sitting there that were coming to federal court, and the federal courts recognized that they were soon going to be flooded with capital habeas, with death penalty habeas corpus cases, and no one knew how to do them. No one had experience in the city, in the state, with doing them. And Maureen Rowley, my late friend and boss, who was the head of the Federal Defender Office, Maureen said, with some other people who were interested in it, said, there's a role here for us to step into. And Maureen created a capital habeas unit, a unit of people who were there to become good at this, to learn how to do capital litigation and to represent the people who were the most condemned, who were the most despised, who had the least power and the smallest voice within the system, because they were people who not only had already been convicted and sentenced to death, but their convictions had already been affirmed by the state court on direct appeal. And I decided I wanted to be part of that, and I joined that, and I thought, yeah, I can do this for like 3 to 5 years, and then I think it'll get to me, and I won't be able to do it anymore. That was 1996, so that was 21 years ago. And I'm still doing it, and we've had a tremendous amount of success of not because we have, as some people have accused us, of having an anti-death penalty agenda, though I am an anti-death penalty person, but because we took the cases case by case, and we acted as lawyers, and we did what we practiced in the way that we thought were the best practices for defense lawyers. And we had resources for investigation and for experts and to provide the kind of defense that was needed. And we were fortunate that we did a good enough job that execution stopped in Pennsylvania on a case-by-case basis. The capital habeas unit has now obtained, I don't know what the exact number is, but it's over 100 death penalty cases that have been reversed, whether it's sentencing or new trials. And the vast majority of those, there are a few that have been retried and resentenced to death, but the vast majority of those people have been sentenced, have either been freed because they've been exonerated. We've had a few exonerations. Or have been sentenced to something less than death. And it's really the tremendous legal work of working hard and being committed and being passionate about one client at a time to make sure that client gets a fair shake and gets treated. 5 minutes? What? To my question? Okay. So, Jules has given me a warning, as I asked him to do. Let me check my notes and see where I am. We're doing pretty good. Okay, so that's kind of my career, and I've had an extraordinarily happy career as a lawyer, like 39 years and still going, and not planning on stopping anytime soon, which is probably a flaw in my character that I can't find something else that I'd rather be doing, but I'm doing it, and the reason why I'm happy, and the reason why I've had this kind of career, is because. The satisfaction that you get when you're helping other people, right? It's just that simple, right? If you can use your skills, right, and your training to help other people and to make a difference, and you, myself, and one of the great things about being a public defender is we really are a community, and we do so much work collaboratively. We do death penalty cases collaboratively in teams. We always have teams of multiple lawyers, investigators, paralegals, administrative staff. It can't be done by yourself. And so I want to be careful to understand that it's a collaborative credit, it's a community credit that we take for this. But it's that collaboration and community provides tremendous support for the difficult times, for the cases that you lose, for the injustices that occur along the way that provide you ideas of how to fight those injustices, how to try to correct those injustices, how to make them not matter. And that's what we do. Understand that as public defenders or as people helping lawyers, that we are the check against government abuse. That's what my litigation career has been. We're the ultimate barrier between the forces of the government, the forces of the state, who want to take away my client's freedom, who want to take away my client's life, right? And there's nobody else there. To protect that person except for the defense team and the defense lawyer and the public defender, or in the civil case, right, where somebody's going to lose their home or lose their children, right, or lose their benefits, or lose their job, whatever it is, and there's nobody else there to protect them. It may not be the power of the state, but it's a power of a system that's weighted in favor of those with money and wealth and power against those that don't have it. And to stand up and say, you can't do that, that's wrong, that's not fair, that prosecutors can't hide evidence, that police officers can't lie. Great article coming out in Sunday's paper by Emily Lonsbury in the Inquirer about the problems of truth and lying in the criminal justice system. It's on philly.com. And against judges. And so I got to argue in the Supreme Court last February, in the Terry Williams case, and Terry Williams was really a case about judicial abuse, right? It was about a judge who was Chief Justice of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, Ronald Castile, who had been the District Attorney of Philadelphia when Terry's case first came into the office, who had made the decision to seek death. In that case, he had the final approval. He was the person who had a sign off, and he made that decision. And then years later, when Terry's case, after Judge Sarmina in the Court of Common Pleas had found that the prosecution team who worked for Castile had hidden evidence that might have impacted the jury's decision of life or death, evidence that should have been turned over to the defense. And then the prosecution appealed that case, and we asked Justice Castile to step aside and not decide that case because of his connection, and he refused, right? And went to the Supreme Court, never expecting, right, that they would be interested in this issue, right? And lo and behold, they granted certiorari, and we had the chance to present what really was, you know, I think a classic public defender position, a classic position of the lawyer against the arm of the state, against the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, who said, no big deal, I 30 years ago. I don't even remember. I just made that decision because that's what was recommended to me. And we said, that's not good enough. That fairness counts, right? Fairness counts. That fairness in the appeals doesn't matter who the defendant is, it counts. And you're not the person. You've been involved in this case. Your lawyers committed misconduct in this case. Who ought to be deciding this case, right? Step aside. And he didn't, and he wouldn't. And the court decided the case, and the Supreme Court reversed the grant of relief. And then the U.S. Supreme Court took the case, and they said, I got to say to the court, you know, what we're looking for is the simplest and the most basic of items. We're looking for a fair hearing. Everyone, and your law dating back to the 1800s says the essence of due process is a fair and impartial tribunal. And that's all we wanted. And that's and we were successful in doing that. And it was a great experience. I had so much support from my office, from a community of people like the people at Temple, like the Capitol defense community as a whole. It's a funny thing when you get in the Supreme Court, like all of a sudden the sharks all come out of the water, right? The day we got the cert granted was the day we started getting phone calls from lawyers at these large Washington law firms who do a lot of Supreme Court arguments. The civil lawyers who are mentioned in the thing, and they're saying, "You want some help? You know, we're willing to help you on this case. In fact, we're willing to take this case over, and we have all this experience, and our experience matters." And maybe it does sometimes. And it was not an easy decision that we made in the office to say, no, we're going to keep this case because we know the history of this case, and we know how Pennsylvania works, and we know the people, and we know the law in a way that somebody coming in at the last minute can never know. And so when those questions come up, and some did, that really rely on your experience, you were ready to answer them. So the office decided to keep the case, and they asked me to write the briefs with a team and to present it. And it was a really fantastic experience, the high point of my litigation career. And I wish Edward could have been here to see it, because he would have loved it. Yeah. So thanks. And for all of you students, you know, we have some time for questions, but I really wish you the best. I wish you great careers. And I hope that you can use the things you're learning here to go out and help better and make our system a fairer and more just system that represents, that respects the rights of all the people who are involved in the system. Thanks.
Have some time for questions. Anybody?
I have a statement, not a question.
Can I ask you to keep loud?
I will. I want to compliment you, because whenever I hear a speaker tell his audience to take a deep breath, because you don't want to expect anything, I know I'm going to get the odds. What you did is you amalgamated your presentation into a marvelous tribute to Ed and to the law school, and I want to compliment you.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
And I want to really turn this to the students first. The students had a remarkable career. Anybody have a question? All right, so the non-students. So, Stu, would you tell folks, Danny.
What's going on with the Terry Williams case now?
So the issue in the Supreme Court was not the rightness or the wrongness of the Pennsylvania Supreme Court decision. It was the fairness of the process in which Justice Castile sat as part of that process. So the decision reversing was vacated by the Supreme Court. It was sent back to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court to make a new decision without Justice Castile, who retired. He hit mandatory retirement age shortly after the decision in this case. And we elected three new judges last year to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court. So it's a very different composition of court. They've had the case back before them since the fall, and we're waiting for a decision at some point when that hasn't come yet.
So it isn't going to be re-argued?
It's not going to be re-argued. We asked, well, I don't know that. We filed motions to file new briefing and for new argument, and they haven't ruled or said anything on the motion. So I assume that they're going to rule based on what they already have.
Stu, would you, please, sir.
First of all, I'm not an attorney, so you'll forgive me. Good. But what impressed me about your lecture is the reason of doing what you do, and that is to help people. That's the most important thing that you can get out of any profession, whether it's medicine, dentistry, which I'm an orthodontist, and I tell my residents when they come in, you're here to help people and make them feel better, look better, and that's the most important thing. This, it comes. If that's what you, if you're interested in that, you're in the wrong room. I want to compliment you on that.
Well, thank you. Appreciate
it. Did it change the law in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania that if the judge has a history from a previous law or experience that he needs to recuse himself if he's then elected to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court?
Yeah, I think it did. In the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and across, as Jules said, really across the nation, because the Supreme Court's speaking, you know, beyond the confines of the individual case there. They're setting precedent. It's what made the Supreme Court argument different than any other kind of appellate argument. In most appellate arguments, you're looking at the law that already exists and talking about how it should be applied to the facts at hand. In the Supreme Court, they're asking you, and the questions that I got most often was, what should the law be? Tell us what rule you want us to apply. What is the rule we should use? And that made the whole argument and the politics of figuring out of how far you can go in pushing for a rule of law and whether it should be a bright line rule that's broad or a multi-factored rule that's narrow and what Justice Kennedy is going to look for because he's the fifth vote. You know, that was the unique part of preparing for the Supreme Court.
What Joey? Was the interesting question?
I don't remember. I don't remember, but it was so good. Because, right, if you had planned to do that, right, it would have fallen flat. But the argument was going well, and I was in kind of a good conversational space. I got the Supreme Court, two sentences. That's how long my speech was to the Supreme Court. I got two sentences before the Chief Justice, Chief Justice Roberts, asked the first question.
Jumped down your throat.
But then it was just conversations going back and forth. And then Justice Alito asked me this question that I really, it was some view of the issue that was just a little bit different.
There was something about, because I read it over to get ready for this, about would this make a rule that the other justices on a particular state Supreme Court could then vote one of their justices off?
It was something, and I hadn't thought about it, you know, particularly. It hadn't come to the moots, and it just came out. I go, that's really interesting. I need to think about this. For, that's really interesting. And it's one of those, like, you know, filler words, right, that we teach people try not to use, right? And it just came out, and because of that, because it was very natural, and it just happened, and I was... as I like to do when I argue, just using my personality to have a conversation with the judges, that it worked. And fortunately, in those few seconds of people laughing, I thought of a decent answer to the question.
I should tell everyone that if you were to look on the web, you could simply put in the name of the case, which is Williams versus Pennsylvania. And if you were to type in Williams versus Pennsylvania, oral argument transcript or Supreme Court transcript, you too may read it. So I'm going to ask you one real quick one.
You can also listen to it. You can listen to the audio if you want to torture yourself.
I have to tell you that history was made the day Stu argued this, but not by him. Because that was the day in the first argument
that Justice Thomas broke his 10 years of silence. And I have to tell you, I'm sitting in the audience and I hear a question. And I'm looking at where he's come from, and we all realize it's him. He's from. Of course, it's about the Second Amendment. But I'm
I'm sitting like if you haven't been to the Supreme Court, you all should go sometime. And just see it. And one of the remarkable things about the Supreme Court is how close you are to the bench, right? Right? That's too far away, right? The bench is right in front of you. It's like 10 feet in front of you. And I'm sitting, you know, the person doing the argument is here, and I'm sitting at the table waiting to go next, like right here. So I'm looking at the court, and I'm trying to keep a straight face. And my colleague, Sean Nolan, is sitting next to me. And I'm like hitting Sean under the table. He's talking.
So can you tell the story from the move you did in Washington and what they told you Justice Kennedy might be upset about and how that played out?
Well, at one of the moots, I think it was the Georgetown moot, one of the people on the panel, and this was great, right? Because I wanted to do a moot. I didn't want to just be mooted by criminal defense lawyers, right? I wanted to be mooted by as wide and diverse a group of people who were looking at this problem from all sorts of different angles. And Georgetown's got an excellent moot court program where they bring in litigants in the Supreme Court and get faculty and lawyers from D.C. to participate. And one of the lawyers said that Justice Kennedy has written lately about his concerns about solitary confinement and lengthy solitary confinement. It's in a lot of concurrences and statements by Justice Kennedy thinking about what are we doing holding people in solitary confinement for 20, 25, 30 years? What kind of effect is that having on people? And so we knew it was something he was thinking about. And so I knew that I wanted to try to get in at some point during the argument to remind them that Terry Williams has been sitting in solitary confinement for close to 30 years while his litigation's been going on. And I was able to do that right near the end of the argument and kind of make that mention. I saw a little nod from Justice Kennedy. And then when the DA was arguing for the other side, there was a point where Justice Kennedy said, "What should I think about having a guy in solitary confinement for 30 years, right? Why should that benefit your side instead of benefit him?" So it was one of the little tidbits that you learn and you pick up from being so well prepared that really worked out.
All right,
I just think Thomas' question was a good omen for me. I looked at it as a dove.
All right, so can we once more please thank our wonderful